Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blowback by Al Pessin, narrated by Neil Hellegers. Part 1. Chapter 1. The six-man special ops team slipped into the village at 2 a.m., walking almost silently along the edge of the hard-packed dirt road, past the ramshackle one-room houses, trying not to disturb the sleeping dogs. The men were all in black, with night vision goggles protruding from their helmets and M4 assault rifles at the ready. The thin mountain air was cold, and their breath, steady and even in spite of the long climb from the landing zone, turned to fog. Clouds obscured the moon, always a good thing. GPS indicated their target was 40 meters ahead. 3,500 miles to the west, a young man walked along a very different road in a nondescript residential neighborhood of South London. It was well into a cold, drizzly evening as he rounded the corner, 20 minutes from the underground station where he'd gotten off the train. Mahmoud wore black jeans, a dark green t-shirt, and a black jacket. His baseball cap and backpack were gray, and the cap bore no team logo. He pulled it down to his eyebrows as he turned into the wind. Mahmoud found the spot he had scouted between the light circles of two lampposts and checked his phone. 3 bars, just as before. He turned into a dark alcove between two houses and wedged himself into a small space behind their dumpsters. He dialed the international number he had been repeating to himself all afternoon. The distant phone rang once, twice, and the beginning of a third time. Someone picked up and blew a small puff of breath through the wires, satellite links, and cell towers into Mahmoud's ear. He understood. All was clear. Mahmoud recited the saying in Arabic as it had been recited to him on another call a few hours earlier. If you do not recognize Allah, at least know him by his power. The line was silent for a second, as if out of reverence, not for the wisdom of the words, but rather for their power at that moment. Then the programmed response came. Allahu Akbar. God is great. The sergeant leading the special ops team raised his right fist to signal stop. He turned toward his men, checked his weapons, and adjusted his goggles. The others did the same. He looked at each man in turn, and each one gave a thumbs up to indicate ready. The sergeant turned forward again and resumed the advance. Mahmoud touched his phone screen to end the call, then removed the back and tossed the battery into the dumpster. He took out the SIM card and crushed it with his fingers as he resumed his walk, planning a circuitous route to a different tube station on a different line. At a public ash can with a tall neck and a small opening for cigarette butts, he disposed of the SIM. He dropped the rest of the phone in a trash bin a few blocks away. The rain was heavier now, dripping off his jacket and onto his shoes. He had another 10 minutes of walking ahead of him. The special ops team's target was sleeping on a homemade mat on the dirt floor of a small hut in the center of the village, a few steps off the road behind an animal shed. He was alone. Blood from his wounds had soaked through the makeshift bandages and stained his borrowed shirt. His dark beard was scraggly. His wool cap lay next to him. His traditional Afghan trousers and tunic were filthy from one interrogation, 2 gunfights, 8 hours on the road, some of it walking, and a day in this hut. His right leg jerked, and his right hand moved as if to raise a weapon. He woke up in a sweat and nearly cried out. It was the third time that night he'd had the same nightmare. The Taliban search party caught him. He was in a fight for his life. He lost. Awake now, the young man heard footsteps. He reached for his AK-47, for real this time, and pointed it into the darkness. Someone opened the door, slowly and quietly. The red lights of laser targeting sights swept the room. A voice said in foreign-accented Pashto, "Lower your weapon." He did, but he kept his hand on it. He thought he knew what was happening, but here one could never be sure. 3 men entered with practiced speed. The first grabbed his AK, another pointed a rifle at him, the third approached and shined a light in his eyes. He winced and turned away, then blinked and turned back, looking straight into the light. The man behind it, apparently the team leader, twice compared the face he saw to a photo on a small tablet computer. "State your name," he whispered in English. The man on the floor swallowed. It had been a long time since he'd said his name, his real name. He took a breath, his tone and his identity strengthening as he formed each word. "Lieutenant Faraz Abdallah. Code word and authentication, please, sir. Sandblast, Whiskey Alpha 590 Sierra Sierra Romeo. The team leader nodded and put the tablet back into his pocket. Master Sergeant Murphy, sir. We're here to take you home. A 20-something Arab man didn't stand out in the London Underground, especially not in this neighborhood. Mahmoud took a seat and played a game on his phone as he settled in for the long ride back to the safe house. He didn't much like electronic games, but playing helped him blend in with the crowd, and he kept his eyes down under the baseball cap. His backpack was lighter than it had been that morning. He had no more spare clothes, and he had three fewer mobile phones, having used each one once in far-flung parts of the city before dismantling and discarding them. Mahmoud had been remarkably calm for most of the journey, but every time he thought about what he had set in motion, his heart raced and beads of sweat formed at his temples. The infidels would truly know Allah's power, and with his help, they would see the futility of their war on his people. Less than 48 hours earlier, the enemy had scored what they saw as a great victory, a drone strike in Afghanistan. They had committed the cowardly murder of Ibn Jihad, leader of the newly unified global movement to end the occupation of the Holy Lands and establish Allah's law throughout the world. Through the acts launched by his phone calls, the holy fighters would begin their revenge. The infidels would realize that their victory was hollow, that no drone could crush the believers, that time and right and numbers were on their side. Mahmoud's stomach grumbled. He hadn't stopped to eat all day, hadn't spoken to anyone or purchased anything. He had scanned a different travel card for each train and bus ride. He had changed his shirt, jacket, and baseball cap in public restrooms several times and trashed the used ones. He was certain that no one knew who he was or what he had done. Hunger pangs were a small price to pay, especially compared to the price the brothers would be paying tomorrow. He still thought of them as brothers, maybe some sisters too. Tomorrow, they would be martyrs, like the great Ibn Jihad. May Allah grant him the highest place in paradise. In his blessed memory, tomorrow would be the greatest day ever for the jihad. Faraz walked to the team's Black Hawk helicopter under his own power, surrounded by the special ops guys. It was a strange sight. American troops with blackened faces, body armor, helmets, M4s, and night vision goggles, walking with an Afghan in sandals and traditional clothes. It looked like he was their prisoner, but he had called them in to rescue him. He had been undercover in Afghanistan for months, inside the Taliban, eventually close to its top leadership. He had participated in terrorist operations. He had almost been killed several times, and he had narrowly avoided the nightmare that haunted his sleep. Most importantly, Faraz had accomplished his mission, called in the drone strike, setting the terrorists back, he believed, by months, if not years. On the chopper, they had Faraz lie down on a gurney so a medical team could check him over. He protested when they lashed his chest and legs down, but they said it was for safety. He threw a look at the medic when he started the IV. The man said, "Hydration, sir." But those were the last words Faraz heard before he went under. The Black Hawk stayed low and banked hard, descending the Hindu Kush into Pakistan. Chapter 2. Bridget walked along the hospital corridor, her navy blue power suit covering her insecurity. She was about to take her boyfriend Will home to recuperate from having his left leg just about blown off in Afghanistan. As the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency's new secret counterterrorism unit, Task Force Epsilon, Bridget Davenport had tracked terrorists, faced down four-star generals, and argued with the President of the United States. That seemed tame now, compared to taking Will Jackson back to her place for the long term. She stopped to check her reflection in a window with a curtain drawn behind it. Bridget had finally made time to get her light brown hair cut above her shoulders. Her suit was tailored to her trim frame and matched her eyes, and her white silk blouse was unbuttoned just the right amount. She adjusted the lapel. Bridget smiled at some wounded troops gathered at the far end of the hall who were clearly checking her out. Then she took a breath and knocked on Will's open door. "Hi, babe." He was freshly shaved, and his black hair was trimmed tight to his head. He wore jeans and a white t-shirt that hugged his muscles and set off his skin. Will was sitting in an upholstered visitor's chair, He flashed a broad smile when Bridget came in, complete with his lone right side dimple. Babe? She stopped just inside the room and cocked her head. Is that a promotion from kiddo? I guess it is. Now come here, so I can pin it on you. Bridget walked over and kissed him. Their hug was awkward. He couldn't stand because of his injury, and no one was saying when he might be able to. She could only hope his SEAL training would help him power through. After months away from Will during his deployment, Bridget had visited him most evenings since he'd arrived at the Bethesda Military Hospital a week earlier. Physically and mentally, he had good days and bad days. Now, minutes away from getting out of the hospital, this was clearly a good day. A nurse appeared at the doorway with a wheelchair and a clipboard. She cleared her throat to interrupt them. Ah, Will said. Here is the other woman in my life. Bridget, Nurse Gabby. Tough, but unfair. Hi, Bridget said. Hello, ma'am. We're just a few signatures away from getting rid of Lieutenant Commander Jackson, and not a moment too soon. Gabby bent down to hand the clipboard to Will, and he signed his discharge papers. Even wearing flat nurse's shoes, Gabby was taller than Bridget in her medium heels. Thin, blonde, and fresh-faced, Gabby looked maybe 22, if Bridget had to guess. While Gabby went over Will's rehab plan, Bridget scanned the room. It was immaculate. All the monitors were lined up along the wall, ready for the next patient. Will's duffel and a small backpack waited by the door. Through the window, she saw several other hospital buildings, including the campus centerpiece, a World War I-II era 15-story tower that held hundreds of patients' rooms. Will handed Bridget his copies of the paperwork, and she deposited them into her purse. Gabby helped Will put on his camo jacket and transfer to the wheelchair. I can take it from here, Bridget said. Oh, no, ma'am. I need to see him all the way out. Hospital rules. Ladies, ladies, please don't fight over me. Will pulled the duffel onto his lap. Let's just get out of here. Bridget picked up the backpack. Lead on, Nurse Gabby. 8 floors below. The small phone vibrated in the pocket of Fatima's jeans. Her breath caught, and she nearly cut herself with a knife she was using the chopped celery for the cafeteria's lunchtime salad. This was the signal she had prayed for and also feared. Excuse me, chef, she said to her boss. Bathroom break, please? Okay, but quickly. Thank you, Mom. Fatima stepped off the stool that made her tall enough to reach the prep table. As she left the kitchen, she wiped her left hand on her apron and used the right to tuck a stray lock of hair into her hijab. The traditional scarf, tight around her face, made her olive cheeks look chubby and accentuated the false smiles she offered colleagues as she made her way to the exit. In the hallway, Fatima checked her watch. 3 minutes before 9. The signal meant this was the hour that would change the world, cripple the infidels, and end her life in the most virtuous way. Her religious beliefs and personal grievances brought her here. Working with the military people these many months as she smuggled in the components, she had come to hate them more deeply than she thought possible. Fatima awakened to the true calling of Islam not long after arriving at George Washington University 3 years earlier. Her parents spent their life savings to send her to GW from their modest home in Pennsylvania. They were immigrants from Jordan, nice enough, but clueless collaborators with the infidels. And they weren't even her real parents. Her mother and father, may Allah protect them, had died in a Zionist airstrike on their refugee camp in Lebanon when Fatima was only 2 years old. Her so-called parents in Pennsylvania would cry this night, but she long ago convinced herself not to care. It would only prove their treachery. Fatima went into the ladies' dressing room, opened her locker, and knelt in front of it to block the view in case anyone else came in. She removed the black rectangular metal controller from a cardboard box hidden under a pile of old magazines and pulled out its long antenna. The device was heavy, with a powerful battery inside, its weight matching the gravitas of what it would enable her to do. Fatima flipped its power switch. The red light glowed. She caressed the bulb with her thumb, felt its warmth. She stared into the empty locker, letting her eyes lose focus, and breathed in a steady rhythm as she had been taught. All fear was gone now. She was in Allah's hands. The task was simple and much rehearsed. Fatima glanced at the numbers counting off on the watch. Bridget, Will, and Gabby were delayed in the small lobby on his floor. There was some sort of medical emergency. All the elevators had been put under manual control to get the right people to the right place as soon as possible. A crowd gathered. Bridget checked her BlackBerry. Nothing urgent, but she knew that wouldn't last. It never did. She needed to take Will back to her apartment and get to the Pentagon before the next crisis hit. She put her hand on Will's shoulder, and he put his hand on top of it. Neither of them was good at waiting, but it couldn't be helped. Finally, an elevator arrived. Bridget, Will, and Gabby were the last to board. Fatima thought about the others. She had never met them, didn't know who they were, but she knew they worked in different parts of the hospital complex. They had smuggled in their components, as she had. Now they were crouching by their lockers or hiding in closets or bathroom stalls, ready to join her in the greatest strike of Allah's holy jihad. As the seconds ticked off, Fatima moved her thumb to the small button next to the light. At 8:59:50, she said the shahada, the affirmation of faith, the words a Muslim is supposed to recite before dying. La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but God. Muhammad is the messenger of God. The time turned over to 9:00:00. Fatima took a breath, closed her eyes, pressed the button, and whispered, Allahu Akbar. Chapter 3. Bridget heard the first boom. Inside the bricking concrete shaft, it was hard to tell what it was. Then a huge explosion shook them and seemed to push the elevator against the shaft wall and back against the opposite side. The crush of falling bodies tipped Will's wheelchair onto the legs of a man next to him. Bridget's head smacked into the door, and on the rebound, she fell onto Will. His chair collapsed, sandwiching him inside it. He cried out and dropped the duffel onto the floor. The lights went off, and people screamed in pain and panic. The elevator seemed to hang in space, then plunge downward, accompanied by more screams from its passengers. The handle of Will's wheelchair pressed into Bridget's chest. Nurse Gabby was on top of her. Then the braking system kicked in, and they came to a screeching halt, the handle digging into Bridget's ribs. Will's legs were crushed between the big wheels. The man under him cried out. Pieces of the ceiling came down, the light fixture onto Bridget's head, the ventilation fan and its motor onto Gabby, who rolled off Bridget in a tangled heap of arms and legs. The emergency lights came on. Bridget pushed herself off the handle, easing the pressure on Will. He was holding his bad leg. You okay? She asked. Shit. Leg hurts like hell. Don't try to get up. You have blood on your cheek. Will wiped it away. Yours, I think. He pointed toward Bridget's head. She reached up and found blood soaking the hair on the right side. Jeez. Bridget reached into her purse. There was nothing she could use on her injury except Will's discharge papers. She pressed them to the wound and winced. Please, off me, the man under Will said. His voice was weak. He appeared to be in his 80s, and he'd borne the weight of 3 people plus the wheelchair. Bridget helped Will disengage from the chair and slide off the man onto the floor. Gabby was lying behind Will, bleeding from her head and not moving. A man and a woman in scrubs crouched down to take her vitals and assess her injuries. They ordered others to push to the sides, laid her out flat, and started CPR. Bridget moved to help them, but the pain in her head spiked and she felt dizzy. She steadied herself against the wheelchair, one hand still holding the papers to her head. She rubbed her chest. Broken ribs, she figured. A Navy captain in fatigues was trying to open the gray steel doors, and Bridget turned to help him. No go. They heard 2 more distant explosions, then another, much closer, that rocked the elevator again. Everyone reached out to hold on to something. An older red-haired woman in the back of the elevator was crying.
What's happening? What's happening?
Bridget answered. Try to calm down, ma'am. They'll get us out soon. Good question, though, Will said. Must be an attack, so many explosions. Bridget took stock of what happened. She had heard a half dozen explosions in the last minute or so. Hey, help us, the captain shouted. Others joined in. Help! Help! There was no response.
They won't hear us, but they'll know we're in here, Bridget said. From the sound of it, they have lots of other priorities.
The man in scrubs, Dr. Carlton, according to the stitching on his pocket, knelt over Gabby and performed chest compressions. 1, 2, 3. A woman in a nurse's uniform sat next to Gabby's head.
stroking her hair and delivering the breaths at the proper intervals. Their actions were professional, practiced. "Let me help you," Bridget said, moving into position on the other side of Gabby. "Ma'am, you should sit down with that head wound," Dr. Carlton said. "I'm fine." "No, you're not." Carlton resumed his work. Bridget felt a wave of dizziness and sat on Will's duffel. Bridget's head hurt like hell, and she got shooting pains in her chest with every breath. She reached up to wipe away a bead of sweat running down her cheek and realized it was blood. A high-flying counter-terrorism expert, now a terror attack victim. She didn't like the sound of that. And she especially didn't like being trapped and unable to spring into action. She reached for her purse and took out her phone. No signal. "Damn. 1, 2, 3, Dr. Carlton continued. Will was talking quietly with a young blonde, also on the floor, who had ceiling debris in her hair and tears streaking her makeup. She was saying something about coming to the hospital to visit her boyfriend. Will was telling her it would be all right. The older man, who had been crushed under them, sat with his back against the wood-paneled wall, holding his left leg. Dr. Carlton and the nurse stopped working on Gabby and stood up. They bowed their heads. The doctor bent down and put a handkerchief over Gabby's face. Bridget reached out to take Will's hand. "Oh, God," she said. Bridget had seen death before, too much of it, but it was not supposed to happen here, not like this. Will held her hand. "We'll get those bastards," he said. "We have to." President Andrew Martelli was having breakfast with the congressional leadership in his private West Wing dining room. The waiters in black pants and vests, white shirts, and bow ties were removing the remains of bacon and eggs with croissants and fruit salad. The time for small talk was almost over. The House Minority Leader was finishing a story about one of his down-home constituents, probably not a real person, designed to illustrate why the president was wrong about trade policy. Martelli was preparing a polite but dismissive response. Two Secret Service agents and Chief of Staff Greg Capman came through the door to the president's left with an urgency that drew everyone's attention. The minority leader stopped mid-punchline. Capman whispered into Martelli's ear, "Protocol 1, sir. No drill." "No drill?" The president's eyes widened. "Yes, sir." "Ladies and gentlemen," Martelli said, "I have to go." He got up. The others pushed their chairs back to do the same. "What's happening?" the minority leader asked. The president was halfway to the door, flanked by the agents. Hurrying to keep up, Capman answered for him. "We're not sure yet. We'll keep you posted." By the time he finished talking, they were already in the hallway. Martelli turned toward the Situation Room, but Capman grabbed his arm. "No, sir, the bunker, for now." A Secret Service agent was already indicating the way, and another was holding the elevator open at the end of the hall. Martelli exhaled, turned, and moved quickly. Over his objections, they made him practice this on a monthly basis. Bridget rested her aching head in her right hand. Her left hand was still holding on to Will. She hated surrendering to her situation, hated the pain, hated the awful people who would do this. She wiped the continuing trail of blood on her face and fought off another wave of dizziness. The air was already getting stuffy. The red-haired woman slid down the wall, knees to her chest. She started keening, rocking forward and back. "I need to get out of here. I need to get out of here." Bridget struggled to her feet, with one hand on Will's wheelchair for support. She leaned toward the woman and took her hand. "It'll be all right, ma'am. We all want to get out, and we will. It'll just be a little longer." "I can't breathe." "I know it's tough. Just go slow. In, out. Nice and easy." The woman complied. "Good. Now, close your eyes. Take yourself somewhere else. It won't be long now." Bridget turned toward the front of the elevator, her eyes passing over Gabby. How could this happen? It was her job to prevent such attacks. Well, it had been her job until 2 days ago. Now, it was her job to respond. When Martelli and Capman came out of the elevator 30 feet under the White House, the small military staff on duty in the secure command center had the TVs on and the video link open to the team upstairs. "What the hell's going on?" the president said to the empty room. "Attacks in at least 3 cities around the world," came the voice of National Security Council duty officer Jay Pruitt from the Situation Room. He turned toward the camera to face the president, adjusting his dark-framed glasses and bow tie. "They hit Bethesda Naval Hospital big time, sir. over half a dozen bombs, unknown number of casualties. He took a piece of paper from someone off the camera and glanced at it. Reports of multiple bombs and heavy casualties in London and Paris, too, all around the same time, within the last few minutes. The president sat heavily in his leather chair at the head of the table. How the hell? His voice trailed off, and he looked at the ceiling. He was back on task about 2 seconds later. Martelli looked into the camera next to the TV screen. All forces on high alert. Maximum security everywhere. Bases, airports, everywhere. All resources to Bethesda and whatever help we can provide in London and Paris. Yes, sir, came the voice of the president's chief military liaison, a 3-star general. Martelli saw him on another screen, hunched over a laptop computer at the far end of the Situation Room. And get me the hell out of here, the president added. Working on it, sir, the general said. We need to be sure there are no further threats. In London, Mahmoud was also staring at a TV screen. It was a mid-afternoon talk show, rich women discussing rich women's problems. It disgusted him. He turned down the sound. A minute later, the news alert banner came onto the screen, and Mahmoud turned the volume back up. BBC News. A large explosion has rocked Whitehall in central London. We have few details, but damage seems to be widespread and the ambulance service is responding to numerous casualty reports. Police are asking people to avoid the area to make way for emergency vehicles. Stay tuned to BBC for further updates. Mahmoud jumped to his feet and punched the air. Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! Some 32,000 feet up on an arcing course not far south of Mahmoud's apartment, the C-17 cargo plane fitted for medical evacuation rocked gently in the backwash of its refueling tanker. The nurse assigned to the only occupied bed watched Faraz roll onto his back, shivering, and she heard him let out a moan. It was cold in the plane's cavernous interior, particularly with so few people on board. Even the highest-level VIPs rarely got one of these giants to themselves. She administered a booster dose of sedative through the IV, and Faraz relaxed. He hadn't opened his eyes. She tightened the blankets around him. If he was still feeling the cold, he was too far gone to know it. The nurse looked at her watch. They'd been airborne for 8 hours. 6 more to go. Mohammed Faisal Ibrahim, known to his allies and enemies as Al-Souri, the Syrian, sat on a well-worn carpet on the ground with his trusted man Nazim under a camouflage shade in the desert northeast of Damascus. A small radio played classical Arab music. Al-Souri's body ached from injuries the infidel Americans had inflicted on him in Afghanistan a week earlier. Their grenade had sent a window shard into his side, causing blood loss and internal damage that should have killed him, but for Allah's grace and the unexpected medical skills of his protege, Hamid.
Oh, Hamid. How could you have been an infidel spy?
In fact, Al-Souri should have died twice last week, but Allah had saved him so he could issue the order. It took only a few words to change the course of history. A saying, conveyed from the mountains of Afghanistan to the jihad's communications hub in London and from there to the fighters around the world. After that, Al-Souri had relinquished command and, against the doctor's orders, traveled 3,000 kilometers west by road and small airplane. As he traveled, the brothers and sisters across the world said their final prayers before their martyrdom. The Syrian was home now, ready to begin the greatest work of his life. He would participate in the global jihad, of course, but his priority was to defeat the Shiite dictator Assad and begin the task of spreading Sharia across the world. First, though, he would hear of Allah's victory. The infidels would know Allah's power in the heart of their capital cities. Al-Souri shifted his position, trying to get comfortable in spite of his wound. It was not prayer time, but he prayed silently. His eyes were half closed, and he rocked gently forward and back. Nazim reached for the radio.
Leave it, his boss said in Arabic. Allah will provide. I cannot stand the waiting. This waiting will not be the greatest test Allah gives you. Quiet now.
A voice broke into the music. News of the bombings in the United States, Britain, and France, the 3 most hated infidel invaders.
Victory, Nazim whispered.
Al-Souri smiled a rare smile and went back to his prayers. Chapter 4. They were praying in Bridget's elevator, too. The larger particles from the ceiling had settled to the floor, but the small ones still hung in the air. Everyone looked gray in the low wattage of the emergency light. The odors of sweat and blood were unavoidable. People protected their airways with their hands. The captain at the front was coughing.
"Try to breathe slowly, sir," Bridget urged.
It seemed they'd been in there for hours, but her watch said it had only been 20 minutes. The woman in the back was rocking again, and her lips were moving, apparently in prayer. The young woman who Will had comforted was sitting next to the nurse, who held her hand and whispered in her ear. Dr. Carlton was making his way through the crush of people, checking each person as he went. Bridget helped Will into a sitting position and stood up the folded wheelchair to make a little more space. He leaned against her legs. She picked a piece of ceiling tile out of his hair and tried to look anywhere but toward Gabby. Then they heard running outside the elevator.
"Help!" the captain shouted. He coughed again. "We're in here!"
Others picked up the chant.
"Fire department!"
came the voice they'd been praying for. Then two knocks from the outside.
"You in there?"
"Yes, we're here. Help us."
Bridget stood up and took charge.
"Quiet, everyone."
She held onto the captain for support and raised her voice.
"We have 14 people in here, several injured, one..."
The word caught in her throat.
"One fatality."
A man's voice came from outside.
"Thank you, ma'am. Please stand clear of the door as best you can."
Bridget shooed people toward the back. The curved end of a crowbar came through, high up between the doors, and some considerable amount of force was applied to the other end. The doors moved slowly at first, then the mechanism kicked in and the doors opened as they normally would, with their familiar hiss. Bridget looked up to see three sets of firefighters' boots. The elevator was between floors, but there was a 4-foot overlap they could get through. The captain went up first to help with the pulling. Next was the young woman with a boost from the nurse. That made room for the red-haired woman to reach the front. So she was next.
"Stand back, please."
One of the firefighters eased himself into the elevator.
"This man next,"
Dr. Carlton said, pointing at the older man with the injured hip. The firefighter and the doctor lifted him into the arms of the men above. Bridget and the nurse helped Will hobble to the door. The two women and the firefighter pushed on Will's good leg while the men above pulled his arms. Will let out a yell, but he made it into the hallway above. Dr. Carlton turned to Bridget.
"You're next, ma'am."
She was going to argue, to say others should go first, but she was in position and the firefighter was on one knee, his hands intertwined to provide a step. Bridget put the flat underside of her left shoe onto it, and he lifted her out of the elevator. Her ribs screamed with pain.
"Thanks," she said.
Bridget looked for Will. He was sitting against the wall across from a nurse's station, a few steps from the elevator. She joined him and put her arms around his neck.
"You should have someone look at your head," Will said.
"I'm okay. Look at this mess."
A stream of doctors, nurses, and firefighters moved past them, some carrying wounded. Most of the ceiling tiles were on the floor, along with loads of other debris. One man in a bloody shirt staggered by, then sat heavily on the floor, stared off into space, and cried softly. Bridget released Will, and they watched in silence as the firemen lifted Gabby out of the elevator and carried her body into one of the patient rooms. Will squeezed Bridget's hand. He leaned her head on his shoulder for a few seconds.
"I should really get out of here."
Bridget stood with difficulty, one hand on the wall.
"Where do you think you're going?" Will said, still on the floor. "We're stuck here, and you need to see a doctor."
"I will, but not now. I'm not a priority, and I don't have time to wait."
"Don't have time?"
"I have to get to work."
"Really? In the middle of this?"
"Especially in the middle of this."
Bridget looked at her phone, still no signal. She surveyed the carnage.
"We'll never get you to my place. You okay here for a while?"
"Yeah, sure, leg is killing me, but you really..."
Bridget held up her hand to stop him. She reached into her purse.
"Here's my apartment key. It's all set for you. If you end up staying here, that's fine too. Call me later, okay?"
Will stared at the key in his hand.
"Okay, yeah, whatever. At least let me look at your head."
Bridget knelt down and turned so he could see the wound.
"It's still bleeding, and you seem a little shaky."
Bridget crossed to the nurse's station and found a rolled bandage on the floor. She returned to Will and knelt down again.
"Okay, let's see that SEAL first aid training."
Will doubled and tripled the bandage over the gash, then brought it around before tying it tight.
"Ouch."
He admired his handiwork and seemed to approve.
"Stand up slowly. How do you feel?"
"Yeah, not bad. I'll make it. I'm sorry to leave you here, but geez, now that I think about it, the Pentagon seems awfully far away.
It is. Maybe wait,
no. That just means I have to get going. She looked up and down the hallway. This is on me.
On you? Come on, Bridge.
On me to fix it, anyway.
This?
Will swept his hand across the chaos.
I know you're a superwoman, but how are you gonna fix this?
Bridget exhaled.
Yeah, there's no fixing this.
She turned to face Will and whispered.
But like you said, we will hit those bastards, and that will be on me. Partly, at least.
She knelt down and kissed him.
I'm sorry, Will. I really have to go.
Sure. Sure, go ahead. Just take care of yourself, okay?
I will. Thanks.
She cupped his cheek.
Go on. I'll be fine.
Bridget gave a half smile. She turned and walked to the stairway beyond the elevators. When the door slammed behind her, she wished she'd turned back for another look. The stairwell was crowded, and the air was full of particles. The going was slow, with injured people blocking the way. Bridget held the handrail with her left hand in case the dizziness returned. Her right hand was on her chest. She got stabbing pains with every step. More people flowed onto the stairs at each floor. Bridget passed the fifth floor one agonizingly slow step at a time. It would take her a goddamn hour to reach the ground at this rate.
Make a hole!
Someone shouted behind her, and everyone pressed to the wall as medics passed carrying an unconscious woman in a waiting room chair. Bridget made a snap decision. She fell in behind them and stuck with them, earning several looks of admiration tinged with resentment. She ignored the pain in her ribs, but the fast descent and constant turning made her dizzy again. The cool air from the open emergency exit door hit her one flight up, and that helped. At the doorway, the mid-morning light blinded her, and the pain in her head spiked. Bridget shielded her eyes and continued behind the medics toward a parking lot jammed with ambulances and fire trucks. She stomped against a tree to steady herself and catch her breath. She had no idea where she was in the sprawling Bethesda complex. Sirens wailed from several directions. People shouted orders. Others called for help. Medical teams and volunteers carried injured people to a lawn that doctors were using as a triage area. From there, the victims were being directed to undamaged parts of the hospital or put into ambulances. Bridget turned and looked back toward the building she had just left. People continued to emerge from the stairwell, some holding on to friends, colleagues, or strangers. Most of the buildings she could see were damaged. At least two were on fire, and water flew high from fire hoses, arcing down onto the rubble. The medical center's tower was gone. The upper floors destroyed, whatever was left below obscured by a plume of black smoke. To her left, more than a dozen bodies were laid side by side and covered with towels and bedsheets in a makeshift morgue. No one had had time to put up a tent or barrier for privacy. A paramedic came up behind Bridget and touched her arm.
Ma'am, let me help you. No, I'm okay. Where are we exactly? Which way to Wisconsin Avenue?
Ma'am, I have to dress that head wound.
No, it's okay.
Ma'am, your field dressing is soaked through.
The fully geared up 6'3" medic tightened his grip on Bridget's arm. He was not taking no for an answer.
All right, she allowed, but quickly.
He took her to the back of his ambulance and went to work. He removed what Will had done.
Sit,
he indicated the step below the vehicle's back door. Bridget complied. The medic used water to clean most of the blood from her hair and dried the area with a sterile towel. He sprayed saline solution and put on a fresh bandage. Bridget's eyes were directly opposite his name tag.
Thanks, Kiersey, she said.
No prob.
Bridget touched her chest and winced.
Broken ribs?
Seems that way. Nothing to be done, though.
You'll need an x-ray.
Sure, in my spare time.
Bridget checked her phone again. Nothing.
Do you have any comms?
Only for medical emergencies. Regular service is down.
This is big. No kidding.
As Kiersey was applying the last piece of medical tape, two other members of his team arrived with a man on a gurney.
Traumatic arm injury and cardiac arrhythmia, one of his colleagues said.
Load him up, Kiersey ordered.
All the local hospitals are already over full. We're heading to GW.
GW? Bridget asked. Downtown?
That's right. No use waiting in line out here when we can get faster service hauling ass to GW.
Kiersey helped lift the gurney into the ambulance, and the other two medics hopped in after it.
I have to go with you.
Sorry, ma'am.
Bridget pulled her ID out of her purse.
Look, it's a matter of national security that I get to the Pentagon.
Kiersey read the ID.
It's against regulations, ma'am.
You're gonna quote regs at me in the middle of this?
Kirsi looked around, seemed to realize the regs didn't necessarily apply. He looked back at Bridget.
Okay, ma'am, hop in the front. We'll take you as far as we're going.
Kirsi was already heading toward the driver's seat. Bridget ran the three steps to the passenger side, causing more sharp pains through her ribs. She opened the door and climbed in. Kirsi had the truck moving before she could shut the door. The siren blared as they made their way through the jumble of emergency vehicles and out onto a road Bridget didn't recognize, with policemen waving them ahead. They turned south on Wisconsin, and Bridget saw that the road had been cleared for all non-emergency traffic. She reached for her seatbelt and caught a glimpse of a stage and bunting that had been set up on the hospital's front lawn for some sort of ceremony. The platform was now a casualty staging area with torn and singed red, white, and blue banners. Kirsi pushed the accelerator, and Bridget headed to work on city streets at 60-plus miles an hour. About halfway to downtown, her phone came to life, pinging out of control with texts, emails, and messages. "Where the hell are you?" was top of the list from Jay Pruitt at the White House. "We need you here now." "Here? At the White House? Shit." Bridget hit reply and thumbed. "I was at Bethesda. Terrible mess. Heading toward you now." She hit send. Her other messages were similar to Jay's. It seemed everyone was looking for the head of Task Force Epsilon. She wrote back only to Liz at her office to say where she was going, and to her mother, who knew she had gone to Bethesda that morning and was understandably freaking out. Bridget looked up from her phone to see the Tony apartment buildings of Northwest D.C. flying by. As they approached Massachusetts Avenue, she saw dozens of people flocking towards the National Cathedral. It was eerie not to hit traffic as they sped through Georgetown. The few people walking in the empty road scattered as the ambulance approached. Kirsi slowed to take the left turn onto M Street, then veered right onto Pennsylvania Avenue to cut the angle for GW. He pulled into the ER driveway as another ambulance cleared the way. The staff was on them in a second, helping the crew move their patient and starting treatment before they'd passed through the sliding doors. Bridget got out, a bit unsteady again. A nurse came over to help, but Bridget waved her off.
"I'm fine. There are lots of folks worse off."
The nurse protested, but Bridget shooed her toward another ambulance pulling in behind them. Through the open vehicle door, Kirsi said,
"I've got to move this thing." He held out a business card. "Call me anytime."
Bridget took the card and got back in.
"Take me to the White House," she said. "Please."
"I thought you were heading for the Pentagon."
"Change of plans. It's urgent. Please, Kirsi."
"I have to wait for the crew and get back to Bethesda."
"It's only a few blocks. You'll be back in 5 minutes."
Kirsi looked toward the building. His team was still inside. He looked back at Bridget. She made sure he saw her put his card into her purse.
"Okay, 5 minutes," he said.
Kirsi gunned the engine and swung the truck left at the end of the driveway to get back onto Pennsylvania Avenue. At 18th Street, they came to a wall of city buses across the road, flanked by police cars with lights flashing. Bridget saw SWAT officers take cover behind the vehicles and point rifles at them. Kirsi hit the brakes. An officer ran toward the ambulance with gun drawn and his left hand up.
"Stop! You can't come through here! GW is that way!"
he gestured behind them. Bridget reached out of the window to show her ID.
"DIA, they're expecting me at a meeting in the White House."
"Sorry, ma'am, no one gets through without specific orders."
He turned toward Kirsi.
"You have to move this thing right now."
"I'm getting out,"
Bridget said. He showed the officer both her hands. "I'm unarmed." She opened the door, stepped down, and closed it behind her.
"Thanks, Kirsi."
"No prob," he said. "Just don't let them shoot me."
He turned the wheel hard left and made a slow U-turn.
"Ma'am, you can't be here," the officer said.
Bridget moved off the road toward a small park and took out her phone.
"I'll get out of your way. I'm calling for authorization."
"All right, ma'am. But walk across the park and go into that restaurant. You can't be out here."
"Understood."
10 minutes later, Bridget covered the last two blocks to the White House on the back of a police motorcycle. The chilly November air blasted her face and tousled her hair below the borrowed helmet. Holding onto the police officer hurt her ribs, and the helmet hurt her head, but she still felt a rush as she approached the West Wing entrance. A uniformed Federal Protective Service officer waved them through the gate. Bridget saw that the unarmed Marines in dress uniforms had been replaced by an assault team in dark green jumpers and body armor brandishing semi-automatic weapons. She noticed snipers on the roof, too. They were always there, but today they were making themselves visible. When the bike stopped at the door, Bridget dismounted and handed over the helmet. She instinctively shook her head to loosen her hair. That was a mistake. The dizziness hit and she staggered, grabbing the policeman with her left hand and her head with her right. She felt some blood that Kirsi had missed and thought about what she must look like. Her skirt and jacket were bloodstained and coated with white ceiling tile dust. She had a large bandage on her head, and her face was probably dirty.
"Ma'am, we'll have the doctor take a look at that," said the intern Jay had sent to escort her.
The earnest young man was running toward Bridget from a side door, his red tie flying behind him. He grabbed her arm and looked at her with what seemed like exaggerated concern. Bridget steadied herself and brushed some dust off her suit.
"I'm okay," she lied. "Quick ladies' room stop, then to the meeting."
They breezed through the ID check and metal detectors, and she let the young man hold her arm as he led her along the labyrinth of blue-carpeted corridors. In the bathroom, she wiped the last of the blood from her hair, what she could see anyway, and splashed water on her face. She couldn't do anything about the stains on her suit. She bent down to wipe off her shoes. She thought about Bethesda, Will, Gabby, all the bodies outside. Her ribs ached. Bridget stared at her reflection in the mirror. She looked like she had been through, well, exactly what she had been through. She shook it off and turned for the door. Bridget would never go to a White House meeting or any meeting not looking her best, but today was not a day to worry about such things. She had come this far and was not stopping now.
"Bridget, oh my God,"
Jay greeted her as she came into the Situation Room.
"You're injured."
"It's nothing. What's going on?"
"It's not nothing. What happened to you?"
Bridget told him the short version. As she finished, the dizziness hit again. She reached out for support.
"Jay, sorry. I need to sit down."
Jay swiveled one of the leather chairs so she could sit.
"Can we get the doctor over here?" he called out.
The next several minutes were a blur. Bridget tried to scan the room, see who was there, check the displays on the large screens, but she couldn't focus. A Navy corpsman got there first and knelt in front of her. She slumped into his arms and vomited a little.
"We need a gurney,"
the medic shouted in the general direction of the security staff. He sat his patient up, but Bridget winced from the pain in her ribs.
"She should not be here," the corpsman said to Jay.
That seemed to rouse Bridget. She was not going to let them kick her out of the sit room.
"I'm okay. I need to be in this meeting."
Bridget could tell that her voice sounded odd. The room moved around her. She felt the medic's hands protecting her head as she slid out of the chair onto the plush carpet. Chapter 5. Faraz stirred. He felt the chill of the air conditioning on his face, the only part of him not firmly tucked in under the sheet and blanket. He licked his lips, then opened his eyes, and shut them immediately against the light of an overhead fluorescent. He blinked a few times, and the room came into focus. The walls were beige, from the floor to a wide wooden rail in the middle, then white to the acoustic tile ceiling, with air vents and lights in a checkerboard grid. There were two metal visitors' chairs with brown cushions. A cart heavy with medical equipment stood to his left. To the right were a rolling hospital tray, a cabinet built into the wall, and a small fridge humming in the corner. He was facing the door, but rolling his eyes up in their sockets, he could see a window across the top of the wall behind him and a sliver of blue sky. He twisted his body to get his right hand out from under the covers and wiped his face.
Where the hell am I? How did I get here?
Memories flooded back. He couldn't answer those two questions, but he remembered what came before. The airstrike, the escape, the carnage at the farmhouse. He covered his eyes with his free hand, as if that would block the images. He remembered the rescue, too, the relative safety of the village, the late-night visitors, the walk down the mountain to the landing zone, the roar of the Black Hawk, then nothing. Curiosity got the better of him.
"Hello,"
he said. His voice was hoarse, no reply. Faraz coughed and swallowed.
"Hello."
The door opened and a nurse walked in, all in white, from her old school cap to her below-the-knee dress, tights and shoes. She was a blue-eyed blonde, 5'2" tall and about half as wide, with a smile to match. Faraz was out of practice at guessing a woman's age, but she seemed older than he was, 35, maybe.
"Lieutenant Abdallah, glad to see you're awake. How are you feeling?"
The nurse checked the readings on the equipment and the flow of the IV. Faraz had not seen a woman with her face and hair uncovered in nearly a year. He hadn't seen blue eyes or blonde hair either, and had hardly spoken to a woman in all that time. He'd also been sleeping, it seemed, for a long while, so it took him a few seconds to say anything.
"Where am I?" Sir, you are in the U.S. Navy Lawrence T. Nicholson Medical Center, and you didn't answer my question.
Her voice was confident, with a hint of southern accent and a clipped efficiency that indicated she expected specific answers to specific questions.
Sorry. Faraz blinked his eyes to clear the cobwebs. What was the question?
She spoke slowly, like he was a child, but there was a tease in her eyes.
It was, how are you feeling?
Oh. Faraz mentally took stock of himself. Okay, I guess.
Let's have a look at your arm.
The nurse pulled back the covers on his left side and checked the bandage covering his bullet wound.
Any pain?
No, actually. Thanks.
Good.
The nurse continued through Faraz's catalog of injuries, checking the gunshot wounds to his right shoulder and left side. That last was just a graze. He had been kicked hard in the chest, too, but that was... he wasn't sure how many days ago. No matter now. When she finished, she tucked Faraz back in.
And where is the Lawrence, whatever, medical center? U.S. Naval Station, Guantanamo Bay.
Bridget was in a smaller but much fancier medical facility, the White House Clinic. The floor was a pattern of presidential seals. The walls were packed with high-tech medical gear and glass-fronted cabinets stocked with supplies. The plush chair where she sat was intended for the President of the United States. The highly skilled surgeon who worked on her head was a one-star admiral. His uniform pants gave way to a white hospital coat with his rank insignia on the sleeve. The nurse was Navy, too, and he passed instruments to the doctor with practiced efficiency.
How's it look? Bridget asked.
It'll be fine, her admiral doctor replied. But you definitely need more attention than you got at Bethesda.
They were pretty busy with more serious injuries.
I'm sure they were.
Bridget saw the bandage Kiersey had applied, now blood-soaked and lying in a basin.
That dressing was put on by an ambulance driver, Bridget said.
Looks like he was driving when he did it.
Got me here anyway.
Bridget was silent for a few minutes while the doctor continued to close her head wound with stitches, but she was getting anxious.
Sorry, Doc, but I need to get into that meeting. How much longer?
Well, let's see.
The doctor patted the wound with a fresh bandage and showed Bridget that it came away clean.
You're just about done.
The doctor took a fresh bandage from the nurse and put it in place.
All set now, but take it easy and go see your regular doctor ASAP.
Yes, sir,
Bridget said.
Stand up slowly, please,
the doctor offered his hand. Bridget took it and stood without dizziness.
Thank you, doctor.
You are most welcome. I believe there's a corporal outside the door to take you to your meeting.
Guantanamo?
Faraz thought he must have misheard her.
Si, bienvenidos in Cuba,
she drawled, extending the last word to make it Cuba. She smiled at him with perfect teeth, looking him straight in the eyes, as no woman in Afghanistan ever would.
Excuse me?
After speaking Pashto for so many months, Faraz's brain was not ready for Spanish.
Welcome to Cuba, Lieutenant, and don't worry. You're at the naval base, not in the detainee facility.
She giggled at her bad joke. All Faraz could think was that he looked a lot more like those detainees than he did like this nurse.
What am I doing at Guantanamo Bay?
You are getting the best care the United States Navy can offer. Beyond that, Lieutenant, I do not know.
She gave him another smile and reset his covers.
You rest now.
I don't want to rest. I want some answers. Why am I here? How did I get here? What the hell day is it?
I can tell you it's Tuesday. The rest is well above my pay grade. But we've let the powers that be know you're awake, so perhaps someone will come by who could answer your questions, or at least not answer them from a higher level.
There was that giggle again. Faraz started to ask another question, but realized it was useless. The nurse filled a plastic cup from a pitcher on the rolling tray to Faraz's right.
Here's some water, and we'll get you a meal. You must be starving.
Faraz hadn't thought about it, but now that she mentioned it, he was.
Thanks. You're welcome, Lieutenant. We are Navy, but don't mind feeding the Army now and again.
She gave him a wink, which unnerved him a little. She tied a cable with a handle and a red button to his bed rail.
My name is Julie. If you need anything, push this button. See you later, Lieutenant.
Faraz watched her skirt stretch tight across her ample bottom as she walked to the door. He hadn't seen anything like that in the last year either.
Faraz stared at the button. It wasn't so different from the detonators they had used in Afghanistan. He took it in his hand, ran his finger along the side of the handle, pretended to push the button, and whispered, "Boom."
Bridget slipped back into the Situation Room through a doorway behind the president's right shoulder and took the first available seat along the wall. She saw the president in profile, and he looked terrible. She had met him a couple of times, and even in a crisis, he was usually cool, confident, smiling. Not today. He looked older. His thin face was drawn. His color was poor. The CIA director, a 5'5", bookish admiral, was in the middle of a brief on the Europe attacks. His laser pointed shined a series of red dots onto a screen displaying a map of Greater Paris. "We had bombs at these three French military facilities. This one is a training center for new recruits. No firm casualty figures yet, but we expect that to be in the hundreds."
"New recruits on site?" Martelli asked.
"Yes, sir." The president shook his head.
"Please continue."
The screen changed to an aerial shot of Northolt Royal Air Force Base in West London, a facility used for VIP flights, including the ill-fated final takeoff of the late U.S. Secretary of Defense.
"Sir, the Northolt control tower has fallen, and at least dozens died in explosions at a barracks and a dining facility."
"I've been there half a dozen times."
"Yes, sir."
The screen changed again, this time to a map of central London. The admiral wielded his pointer to focus on a building just south of Trafalgar Square.
"And here a truck bomb blew the facade off RUSI, the Royal United Services Institute. Numerous casualties in the building and outside. It's a busy area, and it was lunchtime."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.